Hi, everyone. Well, I don't have any slides, and now I'm very happy that I don't have any. Didn't decide to make any slides, right? Because they would have been very similar to what Rokas made. Because what he's been telling is definitely applies. So what I'll try to do now is actually talk through things that I think were not covered, or maybe some things that I have, let's say, a different opinion or a different experience. So first of all, about pitching. Now, this event is particularly about pitching, but let's talk what happens before pitching and what happens after pitching. So first of all, you have a startup. You have your own idea, and for one reason or the other, you believe that startup deserves to be noticed in some way. Now, most likely, you would think of pitching if you say, I can develop this idea further, I can make it much bigger, if I have additional funding, right? So you typically do pitching for funding to explain potential investors what it is and why they should put money in. Now the question is, how do you get to pitch and what kind of pitching there are, right? How many kinds of pitching there are? So you can have events like we just had very recently, literally, this Saturday and Sunday, there were some opportunities to pitch, and there were some ways to get into that pitching. Either you had to pass some competitions, or you know, you have to follow some events, what happened. So first of all, you have to realize and be very active and promote yourself. Find the opportunities to promote yourself. When you are a startup, nobody will come and look for you. Nobody will notice unless you make yourself noticeable. So I know that for some people it seems like, well, you know, I've done a good thing, and you know, it's on the internet, the app is downloadable, you know, they should approach me. Nobody will approach, because this, you know, so many startups, even in Lithuania, even in our surrounding countries, that investors are overwhelmed with all this, this number of startups that are really quite interesting. Now, the other way of pitching is not to try to get to the events where, I think actually pitching at the event is one of the hardest genres and one of these genres that yields you least result. I'm not saying you don't have to do it, but it's you know, it's just to generate some kind of traction of interest into your startup, that you know, somebody will hear about it, somebody will tell somebody, and then you know, it will go from that on. But basically, you would only do this kind of pitching with the intention to go into the real meeting with the investor, right? And that is a different pitching. I think in that you know, it's typically much longer. On the stage, you would get 3 minutes, maybe 5 minutes max, and then some time for question. And it's really hard, because you stand in a huge audience. You don't feel really the response from the audience. It's hard to adjust what you are saying, because you will see that some people are listening, some others have stopped listening. For some, it's interesting. For some, it doesn't. And you know, you have to be well prepared. You have to deliver that speech and leave the stage. And you know, then you don't know what happens afterwards. Ideally, what will happen afterwards, somebody will come up to you and say, oh, it was interesting. You know, let's continue the conversation, or let's agree to continue the conversation, because typically there will be no time at the event to do that, right? So my advice is, and it's up to you to do it or not, but you know, in a presentation for pitch is typically a PowerPoint or a keynote or whatever, or Prezi that you use, and you know, ideally you would have another version of your pitch which is much shorter, just on one page. Actually, it's called a one pager, and this is something you can have on paper just to leave to that person, because you know, it's good. He will eventually put it in his pocket, and at some point in time he will take out of the pocket and remember again, and have an electronic version, which after the exchange of cards, you send it to that person. Right. Now, even if you send that presentation, or even if you've made this contact, nothing will happen unless you actively follow up. So I think you really have to continue this dialogue, sometimes even without the response. It will take time before somebody will respond. Now, don't overdo it. I mean, don't be too persistent, because then you might be banned from that person's email. He will say, this is pure junk. Immediately send it to junk. But in a very nice way, try to a couple of times remind of yourself, or in a very polite way say, look, I mean, here I am again. You were interested. If you're still interested, I'm available. I can come in and we can discuss. Or, you know, maybe you were interested because you remembered of a friend of yours who might be interested. So would you mind passing that over, you know, to that friend, and so on. So try to follow up. And the intention of this follow up should really be to build connections. The more connections you have, your chances increase that through this focused network, through this professional network, the knowledge of what you are doing will expand, right? Now, ideally, at some point, you will get to a meeting with the investor. Now, you know, literally, investors are bombarded with requests to meet. And some are good at following up, some are not, because it's a very hard job, right? Sometimes you receive emails that are, you know, it's like, I don't know, it takes an hour to read. Now, nobody will read it. Nobody will read it. We'll read the first paragraph. If it's not clear what this is about, this gets parked for reading later, which basically means for reading never. Unless they have, as Rocco said, many associates to whom they could say, well, look at this thing, look at this thing. And you know, but this is a dead end. Now, another dead end is to say, look, I have a great idea, let's meet. Yeah, okay, well, I mean, time costs money for investors because there's other opportunities waiting. So unless you manage in that email to explain or remind, if you've already met, what this is about exactly, to capture that person's attention, you will not get the meeting, right? Now, once you get the interest and once you get invited for a meeting, be sure of one thing. Every investor in tech field will most likely be using either Outlook or, you know, some other system that has electronic calendaring in it. Now, the good thing about it is that it's easy to enter meetings that are 1 hour long or half an hour long. And everybody actually blocks time, typically 1 hour or half an hour, right? But very seldom you would have, you know, short meetings, one after the other, just half hour meetings. This is my personal recent experience when we were touring Silicon Valley. Every single meeting we had, every single one we had in the office had an allocation of 1 hour. Every single meeting has taken 58 minutes. Because at the, you know, at whatever hour, 58 minutes, the partner was saying, okay, guys, I have another meeting. Before that, another meeting, I have to go to the restroom and so on. And, you know, here comes another meeting. So, look, what can happen in that hour? If you manage to capture that person's attention, you need to be prepared to actually stay and tell the story for that 1 hour. You have to have enough content to talk about what you do, what you plan to do for that 1 hour, right? So basically that means you have to know your business, because it might happen that into one single detail, you will go very deep and you will go into the area unknown, but if you know your business, you will be able to, you know, think and find a way to fill that content, which will eventually lead you to the next hour. Try to stay as much as you can in control to use that hour productively. Always leave some time to make some arrangements for what will happen next, right? So what would be expected of you if there is interest? What will happen, you know, what you should do, and what kind of additional information you should provide? Because eventually, at the end of that hour, you will abruptly leave and So what? What will happen now? Write another introductory email saying, well, here I am again. We've spoken for an hour. What this is about, right? Now, chances are that you will only have 15 minutes, right? But I would say in that case, it probably means that this might be a dead end with this investor because, you know, he kind of liked the idea, he listened to it, but it's not in his priorities to invest in that. And he parks it somewhere, it was good or it was, you know, total crap, but if it was good, okay, let's leave it there, and it will disappear somewhere. Still, that leaves you a good opportunity to follow up and always ask for additional introductions so that you can, you know, continue your research and go further, because once you've spoken to a well-informed investor, for sure, if your idea is not, well, if your idea is good, for sure he will know somebody who might be interested in such a thing, right? Now, whether to follow any exact structure for the presentation, well, whether to have a presentation, actually, I think we kind of assume you need to have some background material, right? I think you definitely should. Now, what should be the structure of that? Should it be really a long presentation if you are preparing for a long meeting explaining step by step what is happening? Or should it use the editorial approach where you happen what this is about, your full story in, say, 3 minutes, and then, depending on how much time you feel you have, you go in circles deepening each subject. You have to find it for yourself how it suits best. But you have to make sure, I think, that you have the core of your idea in 3, 4, 5, well, maximum 10 slides, if they are as short as Eddie's slides, you know, just kind of ideas. You want to do it in a different way, but I think you should have backup slides as well. And I think Rokas was touching on that point that you do not always get to use the backup slides, but in case you do, it's always useful to have it. And by the way, in preparing these slides, you force yourself also to think of all potential questions and all potential answers that you know, you will be able to produce to that investor. Yeah, what else I think wasn't touched? Follow-up, I did speak about it. I think, that's a really extremely important part is following up, to always put yourself back on the radar that, you know, I'm still here, you were interested, if you're still interested, let's continue the discussion. Don't overdo it. Just, you know, don't get banned, but remember to follow up. Okay. Now, about the approach. I think it was 7 or 8 or 9 points that Rokas was saying what should be included in the presentation. It's absolutely right. But I have always a shorter version of that, especially for me from, let's say, the investor perspective. And it's a version that I learned reading the book 5 Disciplines of Innovation. It's actually written by somebody who's been to Lithuania recently from Stanford Research Institute. And it's a book about innovation. It's not really a book about startups. Well, basically, in that book, they talk about the approach, how you tell your story, and they say, you know, you should always keep the concept of NABC in mind. And now NABC stands for need, approach, business, and competition. And the good way to think about it once you prepare for the pitch is that, you know, the parts, each single part, should be actually the same size. You should not, in your story, be this big on the need, and this small on the approach, and this big on business, and this little on competition. All these parts should be equally covered, so that you say, okay, this is the need, This is why somebody will use this product or this service or, you know, whatever you are creating. What can be other than product and services? I think that covers pretty much everything. Then it should be your approach. How you will do it, what exactly you are doing. And here, when it comes to the approach, it very much depends on the stage of your business. If it's very early stage and you don't have a product, well, then you have to somehow innovate and present on the idea level how the product will look like, what it will do. And I think once you pitch, you should at least have some mock-ups if it's about software, or you should have some drawings if it's about some product. It's very important to show what the product is if you already have it. In Eddie's slides, honestly, unfortunately he left, but I think he spends too little time showing exactly what product he has, because and he mentioned his slides are 1 year old. Throughout, during this year, he developed the product so much that he should be proud of it. He should be showing it. See what happens when people are pitching or talking about some physical products, right? They always show prototypes. They always pass prototype because everybody wants to touch it. Once you touched it, you remember it. You either like it or you don't, but you see this is real. Now, when you talk about the approach, and once you have seen that, the product already exists, some people are using it, so it must be something existing already, something worthwhile, right? The third part is business, and I think here is typically a very tricky part, because sometimes you are in this stage where you don't know how you will make the business yet, right? You have some ideas what it could be, but you haven't tested them. So you only have pure assumptions that 1 million people will like it and they will be willing to pay each $1 for it, so I will make 1 million. Well, possible, but these are just assumptions. You have no you have no proof that this will be the case. If you do, you can definitely talk about these, but be very careful with extrapolations. When people start saying that, this is a $50 billion business and the opportunity is so much total crap. You have no proof that this will happen. So you should be very, very careful with this. In my opinion, in my experience, when I had these occasions to actually pitch our own startups to other VCs, or when I had an opportunity to listen to that, I could see that people start smiling and they say, yeah, sure. Everybody wants to build another Facebook or to build another Google, but there's no proof to that. So what you should, I think, do is to explain the mechanics of the business, or at least explain some ways of how you think this could generate money. And the worst thing that I've actually seen of all startups is when people totally omit this business part. They just don't talk about money. They talk about the cool need. Yes, there is a need. It sounds like, yes, people should use that. They already talk about some product and they say, but we haven't even thought about how to make money, and we don't think anybody would want to make to pay for it. And then they start talking about the advertising. That we'll put advertising. Now, honestly, again, that's another thing. Be very careful with advertising, any kind of advertising business model. It can fly. It doesn't necessarily have to fly. But for it to fly, it needs to become huge to earn sufficient amount of money for the investor to believe that he can get back his investment, right? So basing yourself purely on advertising model, that's definitely the easiest way to say, we'll put advertising and it will fly. No, the best way is when your consumer is actually paying, when he's partnering with his own cents or dollars from his pocket. And now competition. Now, some people naturally think that showing that there is competition or there is a lot of competition is a very dangerous thing to do, right? Because, well, then if there's so much competition, why would you be better and everybody's doing this? So it's, you know, too saturated market, too crowded market. Well, I think it's very important to speak about competition. First of all, as Zorkas was pointing out, it shows that you've done your research. You kind of know what you are doing. You know what others are doing. So obviously you know that, well, or you might know what you will do better to become more successful. But most importantly, if there is competition, that means you are not definitely, you are not the only one in the world who actually thinks that there is a need for this, that there is a business for this, and that, you know, your approach works because you have competition, so you have a similar approach, right? Some investors are very brave and they will invest into totally unknown thing, but there's many investors, many more investors who will invest into something that already has traction. Because once you know that there is traction, that means out of this 100 startups that are doing this, one or two will be very, very successful. 98 will relatively fail. Now, some of them will badly fail. They will just, they will be gone. Well, some others will probably be eaten by those two or three very successful ones. So for some investors, a very valid strategy, and maybe a very valid strategy for you, is to say, well, look, I'm building this, I know there is competition, I know, let's say, that, and my strategy is not to become a global leader in this something that I do, but my strategy is to become a regional leader. Now, what global leaders do, because either, I mean, they grow very fast, or and you know, they want to expand to new, or they typically, they need to expand to new markets, for them, it will be typically easier to acquire someone in the in that market where you are building something very good. So by, you know, in this pitching, and by talking about competition, you are already presenting your own, in a way, exit strategy, which for the investor is one of the most important things to understand. How, out of all this, which looks so cool, so sexy at this moment, what is my exit? Every venture capitalist looks at the company, at the startup, as if this is just, you know, a product on the shelf, right? I buy it, and then I want to sell it more expensive. And why I say a product on the shelf? Because, you know, there's a lot of investors who are only approaching it from the financial standpoint. They give you money because they trust in you. They can't add a lot of value in helping you to build the product. You do it, right? So they buy you, they let you mature, they try to create for you, you know, an environment in which you mature in the best way. You look like from south of Europe, right? You know how cheese matures, how wine matures. So you, it has to be kept in certain conditions. So, you know, they will secure this environment for you, but then they want to sell you at a much higher value to someone else. So in your pitch, and it might be not quite possible at the very early stage of the startup, but think of how you can give hints of what your potential exit strategy is. Because the worst thing you can do in your pitch to investors, there are many bad things, but one of the worst things is to say that, look, I have this idea of this brilliant company and it will generate me a, you know, very comfortable and life for the next, say, decade or 15 years, and, you know, this is a small family business, and, you know, I just need some money from you to help me start it, to help me get this family business started. This will not happen. I mean, the venture capital investors and angel investors are investing only into something where they believe, they don't know, but they believe that it might actually increase in value 10, 100, thousands of times. Their strategy of investing is that typically, and they know it, they invest in 10 startups. Now, one or two of them will be successful. Two more will survive. Six others will die, and it will be a total loss. Now, so with these four, and in some cases with just one, they have to make up for all the losses that the other nine have generated. Well, are you standing here because I'm done on time? Because I'm done with the content, right? I can think of something else to say, but maybe you have questions.
I have no questions.
You are very active in asking questions. Last Saturday and Sunday, you were always asking questions. Good, good, good.
So you told that you should mention about exiting. And the, in the conference, there was a presenter from a big company. He said, like, if you say to an investor that you're thinking about IPO or about selling your business,
yes,
he said, like, it's kind of bad approach because you already don't trust in your business, like, to change your world or something. So he said it's not good, at least in Sunny Hill Road, to mention that you only think about exiting. So
I was on the panel where a similar question was asked, but was it you asking that question on the investor? Because if that was the case, then the answer was actually totally different. So this is another story. I disagree, honestly. I think that, I'm still to find an investor who wants a venture capital investor, right? A venture capital investor who wants to stay with that business forever and wants to say, well, I buy something and stays mine forever. No. What was said, and I think it was still maybe in the same panel, IPO, well, IPO is a very tough business. It's hard to do it. So, you know, what was said, I think, is that once you are a startup who barely can afford to pay salary for yourself and your staff and you want some seed capital, hey, come on, don't think of IPO now, right? It might actually happen, but you don't get focused on that and don't get confused along the way, you know, on achieving that. But exit strategy is needed. It doesn't necessarily have to be IPO.
Pitch.
When you let an investor invest in you as a company, when you give up your some percentage, what control do you lose?
I don't think you lose control. I actually think the investor does not want you to lose control, and he will not push you in the conditions that you will lose that control. He doesn't want to work for you. He wants you to work for him, and he wants you to be in control. Now, it can happen that either the investor or the advisors to the investor really think you are doing something wrong. Well, they probably have some means and you know, some force available to them to force you to reconsider what you are doing. But they have no absolute power on that. Honestly, this is an example of a Lithuanian startup of Vinted. Before they received the last round of investment, the previous investor who invested in them was actually advising them to take a totally different strategy, both in market expansion and where to seek for investment. They disagreed. They continued their original intention, and they succeeded. So the investor was advising them not to do it. They still did it. Basically, the percentages may vary how much the investor will want of your equity from you, right? But it will it will not be, you know, the percentage that takes away control from the founders, because that would beat the whole concept, the whole idea of a venture capital investment, because that means, you know, they're taking the company over. They have to run it themselves, while they invest only because they trust you and they want you to run it. Now, having said this, it actually may happen that you as a founder have gone a couple of investment steps, and you know, at some point the investor will say, look, we love you, but you have to step down as a CEO. You've done a good job so far, but now you have managed to outgrow yourself. You still are very good in, say, thinking and, you know, thinking of the product vision or a solution vision, and, you know, continue doing this, but we will hire another CEO for you who will actually make this company grow faster. And I think emotionally, for some people, it can be hard to say, I built this company, you know, but now somebody asks me to go away, and what's happening here? And there are examples like of this happening with, yeah, Apple is a bad, well, Apple actually is a good example. It's a very good example. It's a very hard story personally for Steve Jobs, but imagine the situation Steve Jobs was not ousted. Would he have learned what he learned outside of Apple when he was out? He actually said it at Stanford University during his speech, that for him, it was the best thing to be fired from Apple. Because those 10 years that he was away from Apple, he learned so much, and then he thought his way back to Apple, and Apple is what Apple is now. Think Google, same thing. So, and I think this, if you do a research, you will find many more smaller examples. But once you are a founder, and if you don't do something very stupid, you will always stay a founder. And if the company is doing well, no matter who's running that company, you know, hopefully you end up in a situation where you say, look, I just don't want to work anymore. I go somewhere and, you know, live off that company. But that's years away, decades away from now, probably.